Back from the RISC-V specific features and extensions, we can now summarize with going back and revisiting the build process, which we called call. So as we saw in the first slide, basically, of this lecture, building a software project starts with our source files, which are usually in high-level languages. So we saw we have the .c files, which have the C code, and we have .h files, which are headers for all kinds of functions, library functions, and so forth. And we have what we call the compiler toolchain, which includes all these software tools for taking this C code and turning it into a architecture-specific machine code, which is an executable file that we can load into the instruction and data memory of the computer that we have and start running it. And we have all kinds of things like an IDE, which helps us with the development. We may have some sort of Git or other type of version control for dealing with these different types of files. And we'll discuss later that we may have an executable loader, which will be used on a more complicated type of machine. So this is basically the compiler toolchain that we see here below, where we start with our source files, go through a preprocessor, then go through a compiler, go through an assembler, a linker, a locator, until we finally get the executable. And that's what we'll be discussing now in this final section of this lecture. So let's start with preprocessing. So before compilation, C code is sent through the preprocessor, and the preprocessor basically takes the files that we wrote, the C code that we wrote, and it replaces some of the text with other things that are then going to be passed to the compiler. So what is this? Usually these things in C, they start with this pound. That is a preprocessor directive. And so, for example, pound include are external files that we want to include. So if we have all kinds of libraries that are given as header files, that then again, then we have in somewhere, we have the actual files themselves, which are either written in C or they may be even provided in assembly, but we just get the header, which has the definitions, the prototypes of these files, so we're going to include them. So if it's just a file that we added, for example, that we wrote, we're going to put it in quotation marks. But if it's something that's provided as part of the C installation we have, we can put it in these triangular brackets, like standard io.h, which is going to have things like printf inside and so forth. So that's very commonly found as these pound include type of preprocessing directives. Constants we're often going to define, especially in embedded systems where we want to define addresses and so forth with some sort of a type of a variable name rather than writing some sort of a weird type of a number. So just as an example here, we use a pound define, and we define pi as whatever, if we want to write the last number of pi or whatever. And then we can also use these macros where instead of writing a function, we can write an inline type of a macro. So if we would write circle area of x and say that that's pi times x, that's going to really replace everywhere we wrote circle of area of x, it's going to replace it with pi times x in the file before compilation. So it's not calling a function that's going to be stored somewhere else and we need to branch to it. It's going to literally do this inline. So that's what define is used for, either defining these types of constants or defining little macros that can be replacing code, making writing code easier and more understandable. Then there are all kinds of directives for compilation conditions. So this is also very common if we have different versions, or we, we're writing our code to be used on different types of hardware or with different types of options and so forth. We're going to have these if-defs and if and else's inside our preprocessing area. So we can do something like this. If we have this define add the feature, that means there is something that was define add the feature. And then if we write if-def, and we write the name over there, it's going to say, yes, this is defined. It's going to come out true, and it's going to do whatever is in here in the middle over here and until the end. So between an if def and an end if, we can put all kinds of code that will be done if something was defined or not. We can also use some sort of if and else to do something similar. And finally, we have these types of things that are like pragmas or errors. So errors are going to be things that if you run into a problem during the preprocessing, then it will print out an error. And pragmas are specific things that tell the compiler how to do things. These are less commonly found, but you can still run into them. So that was the preprocessor. And again, that's a pretty straightforward thing where you're going to go and the parser is going to look at the code and replace these types of pound directives with some other code, but then it's going to pass it over to the compiler. We actually don't usually see these .i files that are pre-processed files. We go straight into the compiler, and what the compiler does, it takes these pre-processed files and produces assembly files. So that's really taking the code in from its behavioral, you know, like high-level description, and turns it into this set of whatever our ISA and ABI kind of define. So it's going to produce readable text files that are according to the ABI. So they're very readable if you get used to them. And it does all kinds of sectioning according to the memory map. So we have hello.c, which is our just hello world type of a thing. That's going to have an include to our standard IO library so we can do things like printf. And then it's going to define the main function with calling printf, which is again defined over here, with this string that is hello world, and it's not going to return, it's just going to return zero. So first we're going to get in our assembly file, this area, you know, that is going to be text, where, as we said, text is where the program is stored, and it's going to tell us what our alignment is. It's aligned on a 2-byte border. It's going to define what the globals are over here. So main is a global that we have to know about, and here is where the main function starts. This is a label, as we saw in many assembly code type of examples before. And then we're going to have, you know, allocation of the stack pointer and storing the return address, as we saw in our, you know, in our prologues before and so forth. Then it's going to load upper immediate something that's this weird thing in red. It's a percentage high string one, and it's going to do things with that, right, and string two and so forth. And if we look over here inside the read-only data area of the memory, there is going to be something that's called string one, which is going to be hello, comma, you know, slash n, and string two is going to be world. So these are pointing to this area, and later on when we link this file, we're going to actually turn these into real addresses. But for right now, it's just a placeholder kind of that points to it. We're going to have this thing that says call printf, and then go and do our epilogue. And return at the end. So what we see here is there are these weird things that we haven't ever run into. I mean, we didn't define things like call or li or return. We haven't seen those in the lecture today. And that's because these are what we call pseudo instructions, and they make things more readable. Okay, so for example, if we were going to write neg, it's actually an easy way to say just go and negate the whole world, like a bitwise negation. But we don't need to make an instruction and go and implement the hardware to that, because we can just do subtract, you know, x0, which is 0 minus whatever RS2 is, and store that in RD. And that will do this negation, right? So why would we need to go and implement a whole instruction that does it? We'll just use a pseudo instruction, and then during the compilation, we'll assemble this and change the neg into this type of instruction. So there are many of those. For example, not, that's going to do this bit why not. It's just going to use the XOR immediate of the source operand with minus one. If we want to say a not, but no operation, well, we can do that in many different ways. But for example, let's add immediate from X0. We'll add zero to X0. That's not going to do anything, but it's going to waste a cycle. Move, for example, is just going to add, you know, the source operand plus zero and store it in a different register. Okay, li, which we see over here, that's a load immediate. So it's going to add an immediate x0. It's going to add some sort of immediate and store it in rd. So li is easier than writing this type of add I type of thing to read, at least. Ret is a return command. So that's jump and link register, where we have, you know, the linking register, some dummy x0, right? So we just write return. And call is to do, you know, load the absolute address we want to jump to, and then use a jump and link register. So we just say call printf, and then that will turn into this more complicated instruction. And jump, we saw that jump, we can do it with different things like a jump and link. So we can just write J, and then the compiler will decide to change it in the end into some real instruction. But we use a lot of these pseudo instructions inside the assembly code that we get after the first stage of the compilation. The next stage we go to is the actual assembler. So the assembly translates the assembly code that we had over here, the .s files, into what we call object files. And these are actually binaries. They're not just these text files, and they won't have any of these pseudo instructions left inside them. So the assembler actually performs two passes over the code. In the first pass, it's going to take the instructions and the pseudo instructions and translates them into their binary equivalents. Okay, so it's going to turn, you know, these text files into a bunch of zeros and ones that, according to the definition of, you know, of our ISA. Okay, but it's also going to remember the position of labels for forward references. So let's look over here at this piece of code, and what we have here is we have this jump to L1. Okay, so we're going to have this branch that's going to branch back here, and we already ran into L1. So during our first pass, we remember what the address of L1 is, and when we run into it over here, we see, aha, we just jumped, we went forward by three words. So when we do jump L1, when we translate this into actual binary code, we just have to say go three words back. And it will, and we hard code that into, you know, the operation over here instead of the label, so we can get rid of this label as L1 and put an actual address over here. The problem is that we don't know what's actually happening with L2, so we have this branch if equivalent with L2, and we haven't run into L2 yet. So we're translating these instructions, and then we run into L2. We write over somewhere on the side, listen, it's trying to branch to some label that we haven't seen yet. We run into the label and we say, aha, that was only, you know, three instructions forward. So now in the second pass, we can go get rid of this L2 and hard code three instructions forward. But that is good for these, you know, little types of loops and conditionals that we have that are very local. But that's only, and that's what we call position independent code, or PIC, that we can produce. But there are a lot of things that we don't have, because we do not have, for example, you know, our printf or different things like that, or even where our globals are residing. We don't know where that is yet. So for that, we have something called a relocation table, which holds the global and static variables and says, okay, these are things that we need to fill in. And as you can see here, we just put all kinds of placeholders that we're going to have to then replace afterwards. And labels, such as printf or whatever, they're going to be included in other files, but they're not in this file itself. They're in some sort of include or something like that. And so, therefore, that's in something called a symbol table. So the object file that we're going to have, we're going to have a relocation table and a symbol table. And so we're not ready to actually execute this code. We have to go and resolve these guys later on. One of the standard formats for these object files is ELF, and you can see that over here. There are other types of formats that you can use for these object files. So the next stage is what we call a linker. So now we have a lot of these object files from each of, you know, these source files that we compiled and assembled down to here. But they were assembled by themselves. So now we have this whole list of object files, and the linker's job, its main job, is to take all of these files and combine them together. And it creates what we call a relocatable file. We're going to be discussing the linker and the locator separately. Often in a lot of the literature, they're discussed as one program, one unified program, but I'm going to actually separate the two of them in this discussion. So what the linker is going to do is going to create this relocatable file, and it does two things. It does symbol resolution and then relocation. So what is symbol resolution? We said that some of the labels before, during assembly, they're unresolved, and they're written in you know, the symbol table and the relocatable relocation table. So the linker looks for these labels in the other files. For example, now we have this printf that we included, right? We had standard io.h, so it finds printf, and then it can copy inline printf, the whole code of printf, into our object file and create one object file, and now it knows where to change the code to look at, because it knows where it put each of the different functions and each of the different files that we assembled, because it's going to make one long object file. So relocation is the fact that all addresses start at 000 when we assemble them standalone. And now once we merge them, we have to actually add an offset to the beginning of the code of each of these. So relocation is going to go and update the instruction addresses, and then go also write, instead of the different symbols that we found, like jumping again to printf or whatever, what the actual address is. And that's for things that we know about currently. So What happens is we get this thing called a relocatable file. The program is really complete. It has all everything we need. That printf is now in line along with our main. But there are no real memory addresses assigned. And that's because we didn't tell it anything about the memory map, and we don't know where things are actually going to be. So therefore, we have this thing, this relocation table inside, that's going to point to all the labels that we're going to have to swap them with actual addresses when we go and do the locator. I'm going to take a sidestep over here because it's part of the linker, and I'm going to discuss startup code for just a couple of minutes. So during linking, we actually have something that's special startup code that's inserted into the program. We often don't even know about it or don't think about it, but when you look inside, you can actually see it's there. So what the startup code for C programs, and this is a bit different for different languages and different architectures and so forth, what it usually does is something like this. It's going to disable all the interrupts, and that's because, as we'll see later, we don't want any interruption during this initial booting of copying code over into the RAM. It's going to copy the initialized data from the ROM into the RAM. It's going to zeroize the uninitialized data area. It's going to allocate space for the stack. It's going to initialize the stack pointer and global pointer, so it's going to give them initial values, and then re-enable interrupts. There may be other things that happen around here, depending on our particular microarchitecture and, of course, the language that we're using and the architecture we're using. Finally, it's going to call main and jump to where our code that we provided starts. So we don't start. Main does not appear at 000. There's the startup code that is stuck before, and at the end we actually call main. So startup code is usually provided as part of the toolchain, and well, if you look, you'll find a file called startup.asam or crt0.s or something on that type of line, and they'll have basically the code that we need to go and insert along with the rest of the object files into our full relocatable file. After that, we get to the locator. And as I said, the locator could be often discussed as part of the linker. But it's actually another stage of the linking. And remember that the relocatable file contains the entire program, but it doesn't have the memory addresses inside. And that's because we need to tell it where about our memory map, about where we want to actually put things. And that's done with what we call a linker script. So there's another type of a file that we need to define that's called a linker script that tells us where the different segments of the memory should be stored. And the locator then goes and uses this linker script, uses these areas of the memory, and it replaces the placeholders that are defined in the relocation table with actual physical addresses. So we get, in the end, something that is really has all of the addresses. The output is a binary memory image that can be loaded into the target ROM. So it actually says where we're supposed to load things into the instruction memory and into the data memory. So those 000s, those placeholders we had before, it's going to give them now actual locations because we know now where the global pointer is, so we can point to, for example, string 1 and string 2. We know where printf was located, so we can replace this with an actual absolute address. In embedded systems, the locator, as I said, is often merged with the linker. But in general purpose systems, we don't actually use a locator. We are actually using something called a loader, and therefore also the startup code that I mentioned before is going to be very different. So the loader, just for a couple of seconds here, because this is a big, big, big thing, and I'm not going to go into it much. In bare metal embedded systems, we utilize this startup code to run a program. But in higher end computers, like the computer that I am recording this on, we actually load different programs, and we don't load them when we just boot the computer. We load them, you know, upon something happening, like double-clicking the mouse on the executable name or something like that. And that uses this one of these loaders that's running as part of the operating system. So what exactly does a loader do? It can do many different things, but in general, it's going to read the file's header to determine the size of the text and data segments. Then it's going to allocate address space for the program, which is going to include the text, data, and stack segments of the program. It's going to copy the instructions and data from the executable file into the new address space. It's going to relocate, resolve symbols, and dynamically link libraries. Then it's going to copy the arguments. If you remember correctly, we call a main with argv and argc, which are the list of arguments we pass to a program. So it's going to pass them onto the stack of the program. It's going to initialize the machine registers, such as stack pointer, global pointer, etc. And then it's going to jump to the startup routine, which is the main that we just called. So that is the basics of a loader. Of course, this gets to be a very complicated thing, and it depends on the operating system and the machine that we're using. So that was all I was trying to show you about how we turn C into assembler, or how we go from a high-level language into the actual architecture and the hardware that we have below. And I based this on quite a lot of books and a lot of playing around with these things. So here's a short list of them. And I also have the sources listed on the different things that I took inside. So I hope you enjoyed, and see you next time.